In the 1980s, the low-fat diet dominated the American landscape for the go-to healthy diet. Promoted by medical associations and propagated by the media, it was everywhere. You thought seeing gluten-free foods everywhere was annoying? Nothing compared to the scope and length of time the low-fat diet ruled for. The American culture of weight loss was well entrenched by the late 19th century, and by the 1920s, many women were losing weight to fit in with the fashionable, slimmer, and more revealing clothes of the era. The preferred method of dieting at the time was counting calories, which is to simply minimize the total amount of calories consumed each and every day. The smarter dieters realized that fat had 9 calories per gram, while protein and carbohydrate only had 4. Common sense would then suggest you focus on restricting the component with the highest calorie density, which would be fat. I mean, there's even fat in the name, so obviously something called fat would make you fat, right? So even before the low-fat diet took hold in the mid to late 20th century, it seemed to make sense back then to restrict fat in one's diet if you wanted to lose weight. But it isn't easy to restrict fat, especially for the American people in the 20th century. The American diet back then was full of saturated fats, rich and flavorful foods, such as mashed potatoes and butter, beef stroganoff, meatloaf, and other deliciously fatty cuts of meat. Desserts were even better. Pies, ice cream, cakes, and cookies of all types. I mean, there are some weird things too, like molded jello salad. Yikes. Combine that with smoking being so much more prevalent back then, and it was not hard to see why coronary heart disease was the leading cause of death by 1940. The medical community sounded the alarms, and in 1948, the Framingham study was initiated by the United States Public Health Service. It is currently a cohort study of the residents of the city of Framingham, Massachusetts, to, quote, identify common factors or characteristics that contribute to cardiovascular disease. I say currently because the study is still ongoing and is the longest cohort study on cardiovascular disease to this day. Together with other cardiovascular studies, such as the 7 Countries study, researchers found that there were modifiable lifestyle characteristics that were strongly associated with cardiovascular disease. Things like smoking. The studies also found that diet, particularly diets high in saturated fats and cholesterol, were strongly correlated to coronary heart disease. Thus, the diet-heart hypothesis was created, which held that diets high in saturated fats and cholesterol were a major cause of coronary heart disease. It's important to note that although studies found correlation, there was still no proof of causation. While high amounts of saturated fats and cholesterol were found in the diets of many people with coronary heart disease, it did not necessarily mean that those foods were causing coronary heart disease in these people. Nonetheless, researchers began promoting a low-fat diet, and in 1961, the American Heart Association, or AHA, an American nonprofit organization, recommended that reducing dietary fat was a way to lower the risk of coronary heart disease. At first, the recommendation was more tentative, with the AHA recommending it only for people already at high risk for heart disease. But when a publication came out that found obesity as another independent risk factor, and with the prevailing belief that low-fat diets were common sense for weight loss, low-fat diets were starting to look real good to the medical community, and it was about to look real good to the general community. In 1977, the USDA Food and Nutrition Service, which is tasked with providing nutrition education, published lower-fat and higher-carbohydrate dietary recommendations. Things such as switching from whole fat milk to non-fat milk. However, there was pushback. Critics in the medical community argued that the diet-heart hypothesis was unproven. Critics in the food industry didn't want people to stop buying their fatty foods. So, under pressure, the USDA revised their guidelines to use more open wording. Things like choose meats and fish that will reduce saturated fats rather than simply reduce meat consumption. But the march toward low-fat was ultimately unstoppable. The National Cancer Institute made their own low-fat dietary recommendations. Low-fat diets could now reduce the risk of cancer as well. By the end of the 1980s, Both the Surgeon General and the World Health Organization promoted low fat for pretty much everyone. The USDA published its first food pyramid shortly after, putting fats as the least recommended food group. These recommendations, however, were not exclusively low fat. What I mean by this is that although these departments had low fat dietary components as part of their guidelines, it was only a small or moderate part of the whole dietary recommendation. For example, the USDA 1977 Dietary Goals for the United States says that the goals were, quote, increasing consumption of complex carbohydrates and naturally occurring sugars, reducing consumption of refined sugars, reducing overall fat consumption, saturated fat consumption, and cholesterol consumption, and limiting intake of sodium, essentially to eat more fruits, whole grains, poultry, and fish, and less meat, eggs, and processed foods. Overall, it seems like pretty reasonable advice back then, and honestly sounds like pretty good advice now. It was only when the media took hold of the information and began promoting and focusing solely on the low-fat component of the recommendations that the low-fat ideology began to embed itself in the American psyche. Publishing articles in journals, advertising for low-fat processed foods, and recipes for low-fat meals, it was everywhere. America had labeled its number one villain, and it wasn't Hannibal Lecter or Agent Smith. It was fat. And low-fat diets were the hero. The food industry, originally concerned with the change, realized it could cater to consumer tastes by simply replacing the fat in their processed foods with sugar and slapping low-fat and no-fat stickers all over it. Nabisco's Snackwell cookie marketed itself as a reduced-fat, healthy cookie and quickly became the best-selling cookie in America at the time, despite having about the same amount of calories and sugar as a regular cookie. In 1995, sales reached about 490 million, and the craze became known as the Snackwell effect, which is the idea that people will go overboard if given a free pass. The American Heart Association, not to be outdone, introduced its heart healthy labeling. Food companies could pay to have their food certified and receive the AHA Heart Healthy sticker of approval. By 1977, over 600 products were certified and received the paid AHA seal of approval. The problem, however, was that actual foods that were healthy for your heart, like fresh fruits, were not being labeled heart healthy in grocery stores. So you would have low-fat processed foods such as sugary cereals, cookies, and pies labeled as heart healthy and recommended by the AHA, and fresh fruits, nuts, and vegetables sitting there with no stickers recommending it. This understandably confused a lot of consumers and misled many into thinking AHA-approved frosted flakes were actually better for your heart than, say, fresh salad. Counting calories fell by the wayside, and you could now eat as much as you wanted as long as it was low fat. So perhaps it wasn't surprising that despite the well-meaning intentions of the low-fat diet, the rates of heart disease and obesity in America continued to rise out of control. Critics argue that it was the types of fat, rather than all fat, that were correlated with heart disease. Dr. Jules Hirsch, a leading obesity researcher at Rockefeller University, found that once the dietary fat content of food got below 20%, the body would end up producing its own saturated fat anyways. The body needed dietary fat to function properly. The landscape started to change as different new and old dietary ideas became more widely accepted. Other researchers began to look into the efficacy of low-carbohydrate diets, and the media jumped on it. The low-carbohydrate Atkins diet rose to prominence, along other fad diets such as the South Beach diet. The early 2000s ushered in the low-carbohydrate craze, which is now being revived as the no-carb diet or ketogenic diet. The food industry once again pivoted to consumer tastes, pumping out highly processed low-carbohydrate foods and branded them as healthy and weight-conscious. Low-fat was out and low-carb was in. The low-fat diet was born out of research in the mid to late 20th century. While the research was sound, the evidence was still new and needed refinement. It highlights to us how important it is for the medical community to avoid drawing premature conclusions, especially when it comes to public health. But I think another important lesson we can learn is that even during the low-fat craze, many of the official dietary recommendations from the USDA, NCI, and other governmental health departments were pretty reasonable if you actually read them in their entirety. When the media got a hold of the information, and maybe it was just oversimplification or miscommunication, it was boiled down to simply low-fat. If it was low-fat, it must be good. The food industry simply followed consumer demand. Because everyone was now looking for low-fat, they were more than willing to provide low-fat snacks and foods. And thanks to some creative labeling, consumers readily devoured these highly processed snacks and actually believed it to be helpful for heart health and weight loss. If most people had gone to the source and read the dietary recommendations directly from the health department, rather than getting them secondhand and heavily filtered from the media and food industry, there may have been a lot less confusion. And this is where you can prevent yourself from being confused about public health matters. Understand that any and all social media, journalists, bloggers, myself, we're all secondary sources of information. We may do our best to disseminate the information we receive from these health departments, but we're not perfect. We oversimplify, we omit information, we make mistakes. If you want accurate health information, don't go to Facebook. Find out what your public health department says about it. Here in Canada, we have Health Canada. And in Ontario, Ontario Health. Yeah, I know really creative names, but especially during these times as we battle COVID-19, if we've learned anything from the low-fat craze, look for reliable sources of information. Together, we can avoid making the same mistakes in the past. I'm Dr. Brian Young, bringing you weight loss info on this channel. Subscribe and hit the notification bell if you're interested in learning more, and share it with someone you know can use the info.